We're going to bring up our panel. So please join me in welcoming our host, Joe Hansen. Again, he's the host and creator of PBS Digital Studios' It's Okay to Be Smart, and he's going to be moderating our discussion today. Welcome. Yeah, go for it. And then we've got our scientists, our experimental physicist, Peter Onyisi. Come on up. And our theoretical physicist, Sean Kilic. So we can watch them duke it out on stage. And so before these guys get started, we're going to have a discussion just about their connections to the film and some of the concepts, and then we'll open it up for questions. So if you do have questions about, oh, there's something in the movie that was confusing or I need more clarification around a concept, that's exactly the kinds of things we're going to be discussing. So you can just hold on to those questions and we'll get to them. And I'll leave it to you, Joe.
Excellent. So yeah, we've really got the central argument of the film, theoretical physics versus experimental physics, right here on stage. If you guys wanted to take a moment and let everybody know sort of your connections to this amazing experiment.
Sure, okay. So actually it turns out that there were a lot of shots of, so Monica was my office mate, there were a lot of shots of my empty chair when I wasn't in the office at the time. And apparently my head shows up for about 2 seconds. In one of the control room shots, but so I work on the Atlas experiment. My hair is actually also there. So I work on the Atlas experiment, which is the one that is highlighted in the film. Of course, our friends over at the CMS experiment have their own parallel stories to tell about all this. And I was there. I started on the LHT actually a year after Monica. I started in 2000. Well, as a postdoc in 2008, just before the accident happened that caused the delay. And then I worked on one of the ways in which the Higgs boson was discovered. So not one of the ones that we actually showed on July 4th, 2012, but an alternate that we knew just before then. We looked at the data. We finally. Took a look and saw that we saw something consistent with what everyone else is saying. And of course, from our point of view, we said, yes, well, the things that they're going to show are, that's all fine and good, but we're the final confirmation that something real is going on. What was shown on that very fantastic day wasn't all we knew at the time. And it was actually, for us, really, for those of us on Atlas, we already knew what we were going to show. So the question is, what did CMS see? And seeing that they saw what we did was really the thing for us. So.
And I guess in terms of theory, I mean, one of the things that's worth remarking is that it's a fairly small and tight-knit community. And, I could just recognize about half the theorists that were on the screen just by sight. And the other half I probably know by name, I just never saw them before. But Nima, for example, the guy with the red and black striped sweatshirt, he was my thesis advisor. And David, the other person that, they were playing ping pong with, bouncing it off the wall, he was actually right after my PhD. That was one of my two bosses. Except right around that time, he was really intensely working on this movie, so I didn't get to do as much research with him as with my other boss. We all know each other. It's a small community, and it's been an adventure for all of us, through those years, just eagerly awaiting and eventually arriving at that result that had so many of us excited for so long.
Is that really what theoretical physicists do, is just take long walks in the park and just write on chalkboards all day long?
We go hiking, too.
Okay. So I want to start with one of my favorite jokes. So a Higgs boson walks into a church, and the priest says, we don't allow your kind in here. And then the Higgs boson replies, well, without me, you can't have mass. Physics jokes, the best. But that I'm not gonna say the words that rhyme with schmod schmarticle, because we don't like that. But can you just put into perspective how important this was for physics to confirm this?
The theory that the Standard Model has been around 45, 50 years, something in that range. And one of the interesting things is, one of the three kind of primary architects of the standard model is actually right here in Austin. He's in our physics department, Dr. Weinberg. And, you know, when it was written down, that model made many predictions that had, you know, not been observed, a list of particles that nobody had seen before. And from that day to today, one by one, we checked them off the list, and we, you know, the standard model hasn't made a single prediction that's been proven wrong. Now, on top of that, we know there's things on top of the standard model that were never predicted by the standard model, but just the standard model in terms of, you know, how much it taught us and you know, how incredibly correct it turned out being is I think, a testament to theoretical physics. And the Higgs, the discovery of the Higgs and the measurements of its mass was kind of like the cherry on the top that completed that picture. Having said that, what really drives us, of course, is to go beyond that and find whatever additional mysteries there are to the universe.
So what's the major question that completing the standard model sort of answers? Is it that recipe, those that circular chart we saw repeated? What is that really, what is that that chart, what is that recipe spelling out?
So the chart is really, that's only part of the picture. So there are two important things. One was the chart listing what particles there were, which was that the circular thing. And there was also this very quick flash of the fact that you could write down the sort of equation that told you how things worked, which was, you know, on one page. Of course, you do that by cheating a little bit. So it's really, it's not just the particles that are out there, but it's also the way they interact with each other. So it's not just that we have quarks, but the fact that they can communicate with each other and make a proton, right? So you build up things from that. So what we are after is not just the fact that there is a Higgs boson, say, but also that things interact with it the way that we expect them to. And certainly from you know, as an experimentalist, for me the point is there's not just enough to say, okay, we have a theory that is very, very consistent and it makes predictions that have you know, never been shown to be wrong, when it really relies on something that hadn't been seen, and without it, it just wouldn't work. And beyond that, you could actually tweak it a little so that it would look pretty much the same and yet not be the same, right? It would be, you would add new particles to it. This is how we still have options open for supersymmetry, in spite of the fact that we haven't seen it yet, is because, well, it, you know, it effectively changes things, but not by enough that we would have seen it yet. And so it's really important to go out and find, okay, well, everything is consistent with what we know, but really, you know, is it really, actually?
And I have a little comment on this, too. I was actually around when David was trying to kind of figure out, you know, when people came up with the circle, because that wasn't something standard. That wasn't, you know, when the theoretical physicists originally wrote down the model, they just wrote down the mathematics of it. No, what David was actually looking for, and in spirit, I very much agree with it. You know, it's like you write down the periodic table of elements. You know, when before there were just an unfathomable complexity of molecules and everything, and then you discover, oh, here are the building blocks, and they in fact neatly arrange themselves into this thing. They were looking for something like that, and eventually, I think a number of proposals were made, and they settled on that circle. Which there is some meaning to that too, but I should probably not get into that part because it gets a little technical. But it's well designed. It doesn't have as many subtleties as the actual periodic table, which really has a lot of information encoded into it. But it's kind of symbolically nice way to summarize the standard model.
So the standard model tells us a lot about the universe that we interact with, you know, the things that we can touch, the protons, neutrons, electrons, light. But there's a number of questions that the standard model fails to answer. Can you give us an idea of what those are?
Yes. So I would say there's three things we know for sure require physics beyond the standard model, and then other things that make us strongly suspect that there are things beyond the standard model. In terms of the three things that we know for sure, you know, one of them is if you make an inventory of the budget of the universe, how much energy there is hidden in the universe, you find that everything you know, everything you've ever seen, everything that's made out of standard model particles, all of that together is about 4-5% of the total budget. And the rest, you know, one thing that was already mentioned, dark matter, we expect that to be some other kind of particle that fills the universe. We have some ideas for what it could be, but without experiment, we won't know. Makes up another 20% or so. And then there's the remaining 75%, which we really don't understand, which also kind of came up in the film called The Cosmological Constant. That's the thing, you know, that could have made the universe expand very fast or collapse into a black hole and whatnot. And, you know, we happen to have this very special value which makes life possible. So this is just one out of three. Very briefly, I'll mention one other, and but won't go through the whole list. The other one is the fact that the laws of nature, as far as we know them, the standard models seem to not make a big distinction between matter and antimatter, and yet when we look out into the universe, all we see is matter and no antimatter. And so something that we don't understand made the distinction, but it wasn't the standard models. So there's got to be something else out there.
So that's really incredible that the universe that we interact with is such a tiny part. You said it's something like 4-5% of everything that we think. So to kind of take up this kind of hard to understand word supersymmetry, this that they're chasing after here in the film. Now to get the rest of that 96% of the universe, where does supersymmetry come in? We saw that funny chart that just showed up for a minute with things like Martini particles and the dwarves and stuff like that. But there are these other theorized sort of super particles that exist. How does that factor into the rest of that universe?
Sure. So that particular poster, that's actually an example of actual physicist humor, which...
You can notice the film's not a comedy, obviously.
Right. Yeah. That was actually behind my head for a couple of years. Right. So supersymmetry gives you a lot of freedom. I mean, it's actually a very locked down theory in a lot of ways, but there are quite a few parameters that you can change in it. And one of the things it would predict is that it made doubles of the particles that we know. So there's a sort of supersymmetric version with funny names of the particles that we know. In fact, John and I were laughing a little bit because the film makes a very specific choice as to which one it thinks that the dark matter is. And a number of these would be not electrically charged. They would interact only extremely weakly with the rest of us, so we wouldn't know that they were out there except through gravity, which is how we discovered that there was such a thing as dark matter. And also possibly through extremely weak interactions bouncing off of nuclei very rarely that people are trying to look for. And there are a couple of candidates within this for that. So basically when people come up with new models, like ways to go beyond the standard model. And one of the things that's on this checklist of, you know, what can we do is does this thing explain dark matter in some way? You know, can we put a candidate for dark matter in it? And one of the things that really people liked about supersymmetry, still like about supersymmetry, is that it has very naturally a way of having a particle that could be dark matter in a very natural way.
Can I add a little something? So first of all, as a disclaimer, you may have guessed, this movie was kind of made for maximum dramatic effect, you know, counterposing supersymmetry, lots of symmetry in the chaos theory. You won't be surprised to hear those aren't really the only two alternatives. However, among many different models, the problem is there's too many theories. People, you know, the standard models was written down, like I said, over 45 years ago. Since then, every theorist who's worth his money has written down models for this or for that. And so, but the thing that makes supersymmetry particularly interesting and kind of a favorite among many physicists is that it addresses more than one of the things, you know, where we say, oh, it can't just be the standard model. And, you know, not everybody's model can do, you know, solve more than one problem at a time, and supersymmetry kind of can. It has a lot of moving parts, and nevertheless, it's got kind of an impressive array of things that it can explain.
So the film ties up the Standard Model in this very neat package that sort of says this explains why we live in a very particular universe that is a very particular way. But they didn't spend a lot of time about these remaining questions. One of the big ones is gravity, that we still sort of, we understand a lot about how it works, how it plays out in the universe, but not a lot about what causes gravity. What's the source? So that's a major question. Where do we leave this neat package and get to something, you know, that's kind of a big deal?
John, you want this one?
Yeah, that's a tough one. So, I mean, in a sense, I guess we could ask similar questions about everything. So, you know, why the Standard Model and why not some other list of particles? And it's so much that we don't know. And at every step, we rely on experiment to give us at least some clues so that we can make educated guesses. We understand gravity to some level. We understand it, you know, at the level that Einstein taught us, that the presence of energy and mass will change the geometry of space and time, and then that geometry will now act back and tell the particles and the energy how to move around. And so that we understand well, but as it turns out, there are four fundamental forces, and gravity is, in a sense, the one we first discovered, so kind of because it's the most obvious, because we see it in everyday life so much, and yet turned out to be the hardest nut to crack. So for the other three fundamental forces, they are explained by the Standard Model. I mean, there are some parameters, some dials in there. We don't know why it's set to that number versus some other number. But at least we can calculate. We can make predictions. Once somebody tells us what the dials are set to, an experiment tells us what those values are, we can now make predictions about a million other questions. With gravity, we haven't achieved that same level of control. We can't predict, for example, we can certainly predict how, you know, galaxies and planets and stars move, but if you wanted to know about particles of gravity at extremely short distances, what would happen if you collided two carriers of gravity, gravitons, as opposed to, let's say, colliding these protons, right? Because we collide the protons, and the part of the reason we can make sense of the answer is we already know what to expect. But with colliding two gravitons, we do not know what to expect. And a lot of extremely smart people have been working on this for a very long time. And it's still, the answer eludes us.
From an experimental perspective, the problem is it's very easy to probe these other forces, these other three forces that were mentioned, because we can accelerate particles to the energies that are needed to actually create the particles that transmit these forces directly. So one of the great realizations of particle physics was that all the, at least except for gravity, which we haven't confirmed, that the forces are transmitted by particles of their own, and we can actually see these particles, and we make them all the time, and now we're sort of blasé about seeing them in our experiment because, you know, they're there all the time. But to do the same thing for gravity, as far as we know, would essentially involve colliding black holes. And we don't know how to make those yet. Newspaper articles beside the point. So
this brings up an excellent point. We're sort of left, the film left this at that crossroads, and obviously it's not just two choices there at the end, but this is the largest machine that's ever been constructed by humans to date. And that's the important question. This is the biggest thing that's been done to date. And to get to something like gravity or these other particles, to get to higher energies, we need a larger machine. Now, do you think with I don't remember the cost. They didn't really nail that number down from the film, but it was a lot. Do you think what will it take to get to that bigger machine? Do we have the will?
Well, I don't think gravity is going to be cracked in my lifetime, unless there are some theoretical ideas which we're extremely lucky and the universe happens to be this way. Okay, that might happen, but you know, if there are extra dimensions of space, we might be able to sort of get around the restriction. But as we currently understand it, quantum gravity experimentally is probably a bit beyond our control. So there's a question which is prompted by, in fact, this issue of the possible instability of the Higgs particle, the Higgs field, which as far as from all the information we know and assuming nothing else but the standard model, so assuming nothing but the things we know, means that the universe as we know it, the state of the universe as we know it, is unstable, and eventually on extremely long time scales it will turn into something else. And the question is, well, is this really the case, or are there new particles that stop this? And if I talk to theorists, it's very easy to stop this if you want. And the real question is this weird condition somehow a requirement, you know, in the same way that the cosmological constant might be some kind of a requirement? And that's a question that we might be able to answer by building a bigger machine, because a bigger machine would really sort of definitively settle the question of whether their extra particles are just a little too heavy for the Large Hadron Collider to see. So there's always this little question mark. If we see nothing at the Large Hadron Collider after 20 years, that doesn't settle the question of if there might be something just a little bit beyond reach. If you go up 10 times the energy, then everyone pretty much agrees, okay, fine, there's nothing there if you don't see anything. So the actual price really depends on whether it's Americans or Europeans doing the accounting. There actually are accounting rule issues. It's in the billions. So it's really a question. Certainly no single country bears that cost itself. So these are all extremely international experiments. They're international experiments that will occur over a fairly long time scale. So I mean, it's a sort of accumulated budget. And so the real question is essentially the stick-to-itiveness and willingness to go ahead with one of these things. So there are proposals for building new machines on even larger scale. So there's one proposal for Japan. There's a proposal that's being sort of talked up in China. There is even a proposal at CERN, although the geology in my mind makes it a little bit unlikely that that will happen. But these are all things that would go beyond the scales that we're able to probe now. Really sort of definitively answer some of these questions.
And again, if I can just add a little something. The Large Hadron Collider, as you said, it's and any other collider that will come after it, is a huge size and magnitude in terms of budget. But it's also useful to know those are not the only probes we have for new physics. There are actually smaller scale experiments, not collider experiments, that allow us to search for dark matter. Some are in underground laboratories. Some are using telescopes that look for very high energy cosmic rays. Some are satellite experiments in orbit. So we don't live and die by one experiment. It would be extremely nice to have another collider, because that's the most controlled type of experiment we can make. We can make our own particles. Everything else, you kind of rely on chance. You know, you hope that dark matter will come and go through your experiment, and you hope that cosmic ray will hit your detector. But you know, it's not as dire as it sounds, and we have other ways to move forward. Now, it may be that nature has just chosen to be in such a way that no matter what experiment we do, we're going to get stuck. But I think just the kind of natural curiosity in human nature will, if not today, if not in 5 years, in 10 years, in 20 years, eventually drive us to, you know, hopefully keep searching, invest more in knowing more, because it's a really noble goal.
And one final comment on that, actually. We, you know, people are actively researching potential ways that you wouldn't actually need a 100-kilometer-long machine. So the restrictions on how, you know, the reason they have to be big really come down to questions like how strong magnets can you build, and how much energy can you put into a particle as it goes around once around the machine. And these are really technical limitations. In some cases, there are real reasons. I mean, you don't want to build a gigawatt machine that just takes no one's. The running would take too much money. But there are certainly people, you know, at UT as well, who are working on technologies that would let you achieve the LHC in 100 meters. And if you could do that, well, you know, fantastic. So.
A pocket LHC. Sounds wonderful. So I got to be honest, physicists drilling down into mountains, secret layers, looking for something called dark matter, Sounds like a bad comic book plot, but I'll support it if you say it'll give us some good stuff. So this film left off in 2012 at that announcement. Of course, that big restart is this year. That's happening, I believe, as we speak. So what's the inside news? What do you guys know about up to this full energy? Where are we at now with LHC?
Yes, Peter, tell us.
So we're a little short of the full energy. And that's just because, again, a little technical thing with the magnets, there's nothing wrong. The machine works. We have actually completed the program for energy frontier. So the highest energy proton collisions, we've completed that program for the year. We're going to restart again next year, and actually we have colleagues I know in the audience who are working on the ion collisions, which is a sort of different kind of physics, which is also very important for us. I wish I could tell you, I couldn't anyway. I will say that in December we're going to have the first results from this year's data, and certainly from the stuff I work on, we're targeting March releases of our results. But stay tuned. But
Okay, I'll give you a really uncomfortable what if.
Yeah.
What if there are no new particles announced from this second run?
Oh well, the second run, this amount of data we've taken actually isn't, at least I could say, so for the physics I work on, which is actually interactions of Higgs bosons on the top quark, which is the heaviest known particle, this we know that the data we've taken this year is less sensitivity than what we've had already, right? So for us, we don't see it with the data taken this year, that means absolutely nothing, because we know that there are some things where you just need to accumulate lots and lots of data, and we just, this year is a step function for some things, but not for others. For some kinds of things where you're just almost able to make it before, but you weren't, and going, almost doubling the energy finally takes you over that threshold, then that might be the final thing. And with a little bit of data, you run around in the streets screaming, "We found it." But if it's something else that's more subtle, and it's very easy for things to be much more subtle, it's going to take a lot more data. And honestly, we have everything scheduled out until past 2022. So we know there's a long increment of, we just collect more data and we understand better and better what's going on. So we know there are things that sadly enough, we don't know how to fully do within the expected lifespan of the Large Hadron Collider. We know that, technically they're accessible, but we just won't have the data. So there's a fast track and a slow track, and some things are fast track, some things are slow track, and you've got to balance them both.
So we should be patient with the large machine.
Oh, yes.
Now, we're watching a film about this, of course, and there's a really interesting, this is kind of I thought originally when I saw it, an odd story to tell in a film, to pick out. Particle physics would not be my first choice for a documentary. But I think it highlights this search in a really interesting way. But what do you think the bigger character is here? Is it the people, or is it the science?
So I can answer that from my knowing David, in a sense. Also, you see, the interesting thing is David actually started out as a film major, and then switched to physics. And he's been an extremely successful and well-respected physicist. But when the Large Hadron Collider came around, his mode of thinking was, I'm in a unique position to document this and do a good job. Not like somebody from the outside who doesn't understand the physics but understands how to make a movie. I have some control in both fields, and I should just do this. And that's why he made a big leap to spend less time on his research and just follow this one project. And it was, I do believe, his wish to not just make it about physics. You can see only so many documentaries about physics before you just feel saturated. But he did, of course, know this community. He did know his colleagues, and he did know you know, what odd characters they were. And he wanted to, you know, bring that, I think, to a general audience to really kind of show the people involved that it's not just about the machine and it's not just about the equations. And there's people, you know, who've been waiting for this for their lives. And, you know, you saw, you know, Barbieri, who just looked so depressed and, you know, I'm not going to see it. Am I going to be retired? And, you know, and there's a lot of people who feel that way. There's a lot of emotional investment. There's a community that, you know, lives and dies by what we find. And I think that's what David wanted to document.
And on the other side of that coin, there's obviously a lot of people who are there that work on, thousands of people that work on a project like this. And we get to meet maybe four or five of them in a film like this. So do you think, how do you feel that delivers the whole story?
Probably as well as one could. I mean, it's, there are a lot of personalities in an experiment like this, and you probably didn't want to see, you know, all the meetings involved. So in fact, that we're actually not going down into the pit all the day. We're usually just sitting around in meetings arguing with each other. I think it was a really fascinating. I knew these people on the experimental side as well, but it was really fascinating to see the theory community, because, you know, obviously we're very restricted in what we can say, and we're not invited into these nice little dinner chats where they all wonder about who's heard what rumor.
Well, we're not invited into your meetings.
True. True.
Keep it civil, guys. Come on.
Would I love to be a fly on that wall?
We would just be grumbling all the time. I really did enjoy seeing the personalities. Even though I actually on the Atlas side, I knew the people involved, both Martin and Monica. But it was pretty fascinating.
Now we'll turn it over to you guys. If anyone has any more questions, basic physics to the film or the story itself, we'll be happy to take them now.
That's a pretty fascinating question. There's lots and lots of different specialties that go into making this thing work. And I do actually like that they did spend quite a bit of time with the accelerator people, and they even showed a bit of the computing. But you know, without all these people developing these incredibly high field magnets, which is still an incredibly active field of research, and not only for us but for people in general, it wouldn't work. I mean, material science is actually an incredibly underreported part of what we do. Obviously detector design, making better precision instruments for cheaper, is also incredibly important. Being able to design. I mean, so for CERN, things are pretty well settled. But in terms of the next generation of experiments, and not just collider experiments, right? But we also have these experiments with these neutrinos, which were barely shown in this, which are coming up, which are really require new techniques. The electronics, running electronics in incredibly cold environments, for example, that's something that we need and hasn't really worked so far. So, I mean, it's actually kind of fascinating. One of the things that we, you know, when we do push the spin-off angle, is that we're often really pushing technologies that other people don't know they need yet, like the World Wide Web. And eventually they escape, and then people do find they need them. So, you know, superconductors have been absolutely normal for us. We use them all the time, and, you know, they're maybe finally getting into to play in the industrial community. So, I mean, I'm more than happy to talk afterwards, but there's a lot of things that are not, you know, necessarily bang on, you know, experimental, you know, the stuff that we show the particle physicists directly, but without which none of this would work.
And as Peter said a little earlier, you know, the next, what is it, 15 or so years of the LHCR plan, we're just starting round two, and there's going to be round three and a round four, and there's going to be technical challenges at every step of the way, a huge luminosity at which, you know, we're going to have to make sense of things, and, you know, maybe that's closer to the kinds of things that you already worked on. We knew that something like the Higgs boson had to be there, that something that did the same job in a sense, because a lot of elementary particles, they only have mass because there's something like the Higgs around. We just needed to know if it was kind of the simplest implementation of this idea that was written way back in the 60s, or whether it was something more complicated. From all the data that we've collected so far and the experimentalists have made sense of, it looks so far like the simplest implementation just works out of the box without needing to add anything. But for all we know, there could be more to it.
Also, before sort of concurrently with us taking data, there was a previous accelerator, the Tevatron at Fermilab, which was mentioned as not quite having enough collisions to do the job. And that was in fact the case. After they finished taking data, they fully analyzed the results, and then they said, well, actually, what we see is consistent, but not at 5 sigma, but at 3 sigma, so not what we would call a discovery. What we see is consistent with what CERN and the LHC observed. Now, the question, of course, we always ask, and this is, you know, this is not a purely scientific question, is whether if they had seen that and we had not had at the same time evidence from the LHC to support that, whether they would have said, ah, well, this is clearly evidence for the Higgs boson right here. Because it was a much more complicated thing. I mean, in our case, you can literally just make a bump in the little mass distribution they showed with bumps in places. We can do that, and they couldn't. So it was a much more touch and go kind of thing. But at the moment, we are the only ones who can do it.
There's one other thing I can add. It doesn't actually directly address the question, but it's something I probably should have said earlier, and I forgot. This is, of course, you know, the experiments have been following one another. The LHC wasn't the first there. Hopefully it won't be the last either experiment of this kind. For example, one thing that wasn't really addressed in the movie was, you know, supersymmetry favors 115. And nobody really said, why 115? And it turns out, actually, that's not supersymmetry's favorite answer at all. The favorite answer would have been something like 90. And the reason that they said 115 is because two experiments ago, back in CERN again, in the 2000, you know, kind of late 90s, early 2000s, they ruled out 90 and 95 and 100 and, you know, all the way up to 115. So, you know, here, you know, they were saying 115 is the supersymmetry's favorite answer is because, well, it was supersymmetry's favorite answer that hadn't been ruled out yet. So all of these things, you know, happen in a continuum, and, you know, they'll continue to evolve. And we'll keep learning new things.
Hi, I'm a high school student, physics C, and a lot of the information I just saw on screen is very new to me. And I was wondering, so is it possible to take the Higgs boson particle and physically examine it? And is it possible to see what the effects of man-made particles against natural particles would be?
So the question, if anybody didn't hear that, was could we actually, is this the kind of, maybe it's the nature of that particle, if we can get into that. Is this something you could actually hold in a sense?
Shall I attempt this, or do you want to? No, we can't. That's why we need the seven-story tall detectors. They are really our best way to hold and examine that particle. Since we make that particle through extremely violent collisions, it just won't stay there. It flies out. And more than that, it actually doesn't stay. It doesn't exist for very long. Many of the heavier particles in the list of particles we know, they don't stick around. They fall into lighter particles. That's just the nature of particles. Because of that, we need something that can take snapshots at extremely small timescales with extreme precision, and that's your seven-story, camera, essentially. And that's why you have to spend a couple of billions or whatever just to build that thing. Now, in terms of a classification of particles, there is really no such thing as man-made versus natural particles, especially if you keep in mind that these particles don't live forever. No matter how you make them, they'll only last a fraction of a second. And, nature makes them through collisions every now and then, and they disappear. And we make them through collisions every now and then, and they disappear. But the driving principle of particle physics is that once you get down to extremely small scales, distances, times, there is a small, relatively simple, once you cast it in the right mathematical language, but universal laws. And so there is one Higgs particle, and there isn't, the man-made Higgs particle versus the natural. That little circle with the entries, that's all we've got. And everything is made out of that. It doesn't matter, how you make it. They behave universally the same. If you do the experiment today or tomorrow, here or on another galaxy, it's kind of the thing about the fascination of the physics is that those laws, unlike, we have some tax laws in this country, we have different tax laws in another country. Those are the laws that apply everywhere all the time, and they've applied since the beginning of the universe and will keep applying for billions, maybe trillions of years. And that's why we can maybe take more satisfaction in our job, because we feel like we're not just answering something that's only true here or only today, but we're really kind of going deep into the mysteries of nature.
Maybe I should say a little bit on the experimental side for that. Actually, I never liked this analogy, but I'll stick to it anyway. So, somewhere in the beginning of the film, there was this example of colliding two cars together, and stuff came out. Right? And I don't like it because the stuff you would see is only what was in the cars to begin with. And in our case, it's more like we collide two Toyotas together. We look at what came out and say, well, actually, this was a Bentley for a very short amount of time. And it's really an extremely short amount of time. It's 10 to the minus 22 seconds, which I'm not going to try and translate into trillionth, 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 whatever. But it's an incredibly short time that the Higgs boson lives. And so we never actually see it directly. All we see is that it turns into other things, and those things turn into other things, and there's a cascade. And at the end of it, we say, well, what we see in the detector, the stuff that's long-lived enough for us to actually see, is consistent with what we would expect if there was a Higgs boson produced. And then there's lots of other things that can mimic that same kind of behavior, and so we have to statistically try and separate one from the other, and so that's why it takes a while. So I think that the rate we were able to achieve, we were doing something like a Higgs every minute, and there's, meanwhile, every second, literally a billion things going on as well. So you have to separate that one per minute from the, 60 billion per minute of other stuff that's happening. So it's really kind of it's a fun little detective chase.
Yeah, knowing what experimentalists actually do, a needle in a haystack would be a fun day for them. It would just be, oh, that's easy.
Yeah.
Now I know why you sit in your office and draw instead, right? I have time for one more question, I think.
Uh, Let me see if I understood. Are you asking whether Newtonian mechanics is irrelevant or whether quantum mechanics is irrelevant?
Quantum mechanics becomes kind of less relevant to explain how mass interacts with the environment, or it's always there.
It's all a question of scale. So any realm of physics, for any experiment you want to do, for anything you want to measure, the kind of the fundamental laws of physics will hold, but may not be the most efficient way for you to address whichever question you want to answer. So for example, Newtonian mechanics has been corrected in many ways. One of them is relativity. And you know, if you do it with relativity, you'll always get the right answer. But it's a harder calculation. And as long as things don't go very fast, let's say compared to the speed of light, even if you do it the Newtonian way, you'll still get the right answer. Maybe up to, you know, maybe you'll make a mistake in the 10th decimal place, et cetera. So the question really to ask is, the scale at which I'm doing the experiment, either the time scale or the length scale, does it make, say, quantum mechanics necessary? And in fact, do I have to go even beyond that? Now, as it turns out, there is nothing beyond that we know of. So the standard model is written using the rules of quantum mechanics. It's actually quantum mechanics and relativity combined, which kind of come under the topic of quantum field theory. But that is the framework of standard model. So at no point has the quantum mechanics become irrelevant. There are easier questions that you can ask where you don't have to invoke the full strength of the quantum mechanics, which is a powerful framework, where you can answer it with Newtonian methods. But that was a long answer, but the short answer is no. What you've seen in this film very much relies on quantum mechanics.
I will give an example of quantum mechanics being relevant for your everyday life. So you are happily seated in your chair, right? You are not passing through your chair in spite of the fact that you are mostly empty space and so is the chair. And that is because of quantum mechanics. It's actually the Pauli exclusion principle. Your atoms do not want to go through the atoms of the chair. And so there actually are very large scale ways in which Newtonian mechanics would tell you, okay, you know, I'm sitting on a chair, there's some force that's acting it, but it doesn't tell you why you aren't just going through it.
And to blow your mind even more, you're actually not even touching your chair.
Yeah.
But we can get into that later. One final quick question for you guys before we end this. But what is CERN's obsession with Comic Sans? I don't know if anybody noticed this.
I knew this was coming.
This is Fabiola's obsession with Comic Sans.
But is it still there?
All her talks are in Comic Sans.
I have one very quick final one for you guys. And as a theoretical physicist, John, what question motivates you the most in your search?
Oh, that changes from day to day. I mean, if I can cheat, right? If you just give me one question, I'll say, what is the theory of everything? But no, there are many subparts to that. Maybe I'll answer by putting my money where my mouth is. Because basically every day, every month, every year, I make a choice on how much of my time in research I will spend on any one topic. And I guess these days I'm spending a little more time on dark matter than on collider physics. But so I don't want to say that makes me more interested in dark matter than anything. I'm really just fascinated by it all. But you know, if you just wanted to put a gun at my head and say, give me one answer, I'd say, I guess since I'm spending more time on dark matter these days, maybe that. But no, it's just there's so much. I couldn't choose one.
Well, I spend all my time worrying about Higgs boson. It was hinted at again, but I will say, I mean, the story of the Higgs boson is not over, right? We've seen it, but we sort of know at the 20% level that it behaves like what the standard model would predict, right? So you've seen a thing X, and we're like, well, is X really this thing that we claim it to be? And so you actually notice that Joe and Candela said we have observed a new boson. He did not say we have observed the Higgs particle. And so this is a long story. That's one of the reasons that we're going to keep running the accelerator for a long time, is to really understand in detail, you know, hopefully getting to 5% or better, the properties of this thing. Because it could be that the answer to what else is out there, what other particles are. We're going to find, not by directly making them, but by instead in seeing how they tweak the properties of the Higgs boson, that we find it's not exactly what we expected to see, but it's somehow different. And so that's what I'm focusing on.
Well, thank you both for joining us, for contributing your expertise to this film. And thank you all for your questions. And
yeah, thanks to the Austin Film Society for giving us the opportunity to kind of represent our side of things here.